Hey everybody, good to have you with me. I love teaching the Word of God. I love meditating in it. I love just diving into it. I can't seem to get enough of it. And there's never a year that goes by, a month that goes by, that something in God's Word just excites me. And we start talking about it around the house and with family. And I always want that to come through in the messages, how rich and beautiful and powerful the Word of God is. And so today, I want to talk a little bit about the process of faith. So many people, they just give up on developing a faith life, or they've kind of adhered to teaching that's not complete, and it's just confess the word and everything's going to be okay, and some get into works and some get bored, and some it doesn't seem to do anything at all for them. And so I want to really dive in and unpack this in a way that makes you have an aha moment when it comes to the Word of God. When God created us and we fell, He knew that we would have to be taught who we are when we gave our lives to Jesus Christ. Because we're being raised in a fallen world by parents who are fallen. We haven't been able to use our faith like God did in creation for thousands and tens of thousands of years. And so He knew the Word of God would have to show us how to be who we really are. And so if we're going to live an abundant life on this planet, because one of the most amazing verses that I've quoted my entire life was my favorite verse as a teenager, is John 10:10. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus said, but I am come that you could have life and have it to abundance. And that word there means superior in quality, innumerable in quantity. As believers on this planet, we're to be the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. We are to have superior lives, a quality that makes everybody look and get jealous, is what the Bible says. A quantity of everything that we move into that people are just going, wow. And then they look at the goodness of God in our lives and they say, what is different about you? I want what you've got. And we can't ever claim, well, this is just me. I'm pretty good, huh? No, we go, oh man, it's the favor of God on my life. It's all that God is doing for me. And so if we're really going to live this life of walking out this superior life, walking out this supernatural, it's above what the natural world, meaning the fallen world, ever could do. And so as we talk about the process, I'm going to just explain a little bit so that you understand how crucial this is. You see, if you are ever going to rise up and make changes in your life, you have to know that there is a part of you, okay, you are a three-part being, body, soul, spirit. You are all three, but your spirit man you can't see. Your soul is your emotions, your thinking, your will, and this is your earth suit, your body. Now, but the Bible talks about something called a heart, and it doesn't mean your physical heart. It means this area that kind of, it's like an area that overlaps spirit, overlaps soul, and it's where your identity, what you really believe, is in something called, the Bible calls, your heart. Now, in this area called the heart, the Bible explains it in a modern word would be there's an autopilot inside of you. And you know what really ticks me off is that I did not program my autopilot. My parents did, my grandpa did, my teachers did, my friends that I hung out with did. How people treated me, that did it. My response, the beliefs that I have over the experiences of my life, emotional things that took place, teasing, anger, bullying, etc. All of these emotions in me growing up as a little kid formed beliefs. Now, these beliefs are always around my identity. Who is Leon? Who am I? What can I do? And, you know, how do I relate to people? What do people think about me? What does the opposite sex think about me? What does, you know, all of these beliefs are already deep on the inside of you. And so you have a heart. Now, this heart is the autopilot, much like a plane. It has been determining what's going on in your life. and you didn't even program it. It's been determining whether you pursue things that are good or things that aren't. It determines how you feel about yourself and what you reach for, what you attempt in life has all been determined. I don't want to talk about it. I want you to kind of identify it quickly. This thing called the heart. It's the autopilot. It is what? See, an autopilot's determining the future of every jet. When you get in a jet, you take off from the airport, you put in the autopilot where it's going. This jet is going to Sault Ste. Marie. This jet is going to Oslo. And as you put that thing in, you have determined the future destination. You've punched in that Oslo, Sault Ste. Marie, and that is where it's going to go. And so in our lives, there has been a pre-programming, a deeper belief system. And the thing is, it's underneath your conscious thinking. You know, you could almost call it like the psychology world calls it the subconscious. It is. It's below things you might even recognize. And the Bible teaches us only God's word is going to help you, or you'll struggle your entire life. In fact, the more you struggle, sometimes the harder life gets. You'll struggle till you're so frustrated, discouraged, and disappointed because you can't lose weight. You can't have joy. You can't seem to make relationships work. You can't seem to get finances to work. You can't seem to find peace. You can't. All of these areas are determined by something called your heart, which is your autopilot. Now, very few people talk about this. They'll talk about renewing the mind, then, which is a part of it. And so we've got to understand that there has to be a way to change the heart. Now, in the heart is something called faith. Now, this faith is so powerful that it causes your problems in life to move out of the way. This faith is so powerful that when you speak to things, they must obey you in the natural world. Literally, the subatomic particles that make up all of creation are listening, and they are malleable. Everything that you believe and speak is causing things to change in your body. What is attracted to you? I mean, opportunities, etc. The kinds of people. All of this is determined by the heart and the beliefs of the heart. And so that's why autopilot is a great modern day look at it. Now, if you want to change the heart, it's crazy hard. You know, it's like a pilot who just punched in the computers right here. He punches in Oslo. And then he can relax, have a cup of coffee, chat with the co-pilot. And then he goes, I don't want to go to Oslo. I want to go to Sault Ste. Marie. So he grabs the thing and he goes, and he's going to take this thing over to Sault Ste. Marie, and he gets it on course for Sault Ste. Marie. Then he grabs a cup of coffee, relaxes a little bit, and that plane of its own volition, because the autopilot is determining its future, goes, and comes straight back on for Oslo. He can go Sault Ste. Marie, and he can hold it for a while, but at some point he's going to get tired. At some point he's going to need a cup of coffee or go to the bathroom or something, and when he begins to relax, that jet just straight back onto the autopilot. And it's a great example of Christians who are trying to change their lives, but they're changing their behavior. They're changing their behavior, but not their autopilot. The pilot is changing the direction of that plane. On the outside, the plane is changing. But the inside autopilot needs to be redone, reprogrammed. And if it's not, then for the rest of his life flying this plane, he'll be continually and forever trying to change the behavior of that plane, trying to change the behavior, when all he would have to do is Sault Ste. Marie, bum, bum, and the plane just goes and goes to Sault Ste. Marie on its own. As we get into the study of the heart, you will see that once you program, once you begin to connect with God at the heart level, the heart will produce the things you desire even while you sleep, and you won't even know how it's connecting the dots, attracting things, repelling things, shutting some things down, allowing other things in. The heart produces by itself, it says in Mark chapter 4, and you don't even know how. It's just this incredible thing that God has placed on the inside of you and I. So when we talk about the heart, now the reprogramming or the persuading of the heart of new beliefs, of new things deep, that's the issue of faith. When I talk about the process of faith, I'm talking about the ability to change the deepest beliefs you've got, beliefs you don't even understand that you have. So as we dive into this, recognize that faith is not this, we don't know what's going to happen. I often say it's kind of like Forrest Gump, and life is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. No, God is like a box of chocolates. You never know what God's going to do. I disagree. I know what God is going to do. God is only going to do things for my good. God is only going to do things that bring peace and joy and blessing and healing and health, because that's what He's promised. And He is a God of His word. Now, He might surprise me with new and beautiful ways of doing it, and doing it ways I've never seen before, but He's not going to do bad. Now, this process of faith is taught to us in Mark chapter 4, and it's in many other chapters as well, in Matthew and in Luke and in John, and all through the Bible, actually, it's taught, and it is the process that we call sowing and reaping, or we don't hear that very often because most of us live in cities. It's farming. So in farming, it is planting the seed and then harvesting the seed. Now, when you plant one seed for an apple tree, you don't get one seed back. You get thousands of apples and hundreds of thousands of apple seeds. So when you plant something in your heart, it just explodes with growth. And so to understand this process of I need to plant things in my heart, and then my heart will grow it. Now, when you were growing up, the way you got these deep, deep beliefs was because of repetition and emotion. If you were continually, for example, if you were continually told you're worthless, you're the black sheep of the family, you're no good, by your parents or people at school or friends who told you that every day of your life, playing grade one, grade two, grade three, repetition. Or it can be a one-time massive emotional experience. Maybe you wet your pants at school and everyone from that point on just says, look at this jerk, look at it, and you're so embarrassed and ashamed that forever that thing is, I'm a nobody, I'm just a jerk, I'm a loser, because they called you that during this emotional experience as a young kid in grade school. And so the heart has all these beliefs. And try as they may, a modern psychology and counselors can't seem to get rid of them. So what they say is, we can't bring change deep on the inside, but we'll help you modify your behavior. But what the Bible does is it goes down deep into your heart, and it brings about incredible change. As we look at some of the things that are happening here with the COVID-19 and the whole world being shut down, so much of it, people are very aware of, is your heart filled with fear or is it filled with faith? Is it filled with peace or is it filled with worry and concern? Well, it's whatever's been programmed, whatever you have connected with at the heart level. And so we need, every one of us, me included, needs to persuade my heart with the word of God. Every new level I want to go to that I'm not at, then I don't have the faith for it, meaning I'm not there yet. I need to grow it. I need to get the process started. And so I want to encourage you that if there's things that you desire but you're not seeing yet, then don't be afraid of that. You yet haven't got the process of faith working to get it there, but you can. So what do you go? You go back to this beautiful hope. Abraham, who against hope, believed in hope. And hope is this confident expectation that things are going to change, that things are going to get good. So we want to understand that there's a process to faith. And if you will, every day of your life, begin to plant God's word in your heart, God's truths, God's way of thinking, how God created you, this owner's manual, if you'll begin to plant this in your heart. And every day, just keep mixing faith with it through speaking, because hearing is powerful, and meditating and connecting with God. Then you're going to find this heart's going to be persuaded to be who you really is. One of Satan's greatest lies is to keep you thinking, and religion does this, that you are the old you. So you're still a sinner. You're still a loser when it comes to addictions. You're still a loser when it comes to all the areas you can't seem to get victory over. So we need to understand that in 1 John 5:4, this is the victory that overcomes everything in the world. It is our faith life. And this faith doesn't come out of our head. This faith doesn't come out of our knowledge base. This faith doesn't come from our ground. This faith rises up out of our heart. When the Bible says in Mark 11, 22, 23, 24, it says that we cannot doubt in our heart, but believe. Believe where? In our heart. There are doubts and beliefs that are of the heart. These are the things I want you to begin to understand how to get to them. All right, so when we talk about this process of faith, there's a couple of things I want you to know as we open this topic up, and that is that you really need to understand what took place at the cross, his death, his burial, the resurrection of Jesus, and when he ascends to the right hand of God on the throne. You need to understand these four things. They are the foundation of powerful faith, heart faith. Then you'll need to use this process of planting and harvesting to begin to make sure that the revelation of the cross becomes something that is yours. Then you're going to need to establish your identity with this same process of planting the word and speaking the word and meditating on your identity. Who are you is the hugest issue, but you won't know who you are till you understand the cross. Then you'll need to know who God is, and you'll need to begin to plant that, because you've been so full of thoughts and ideas that, you know, acts of God, that's tornadoes. God might not want you. God's going to get you. God's going to send you to hell. God hates liars, whatever. So we've got to know who God is. Then we have to understand faith and grace, these incredible power twins. Faith is your part. Grace is God's part. And there's Christians on both sides. On one side, we've got God's grace, which is his ability, his unearned favor working in your life. This is what God does. But then you got faith. Now, faith has to believe in grace in order to activate it. So you can't just say, well, God's going to look after me. Well, you can if that faith is actually in your heart. If you've actually worked the process of faith in that area of protection, etc., you can just be as easy and relaxed and rest in God because of it. But if you just say that as a religious thing to say, and you have not dug deep in your life like the two houses, one on the rock, one on the sand, if you haven't dug the foundation of your life down to Jesus, who he is, his word, he's the Logos, and this process, then when the storm blows, you aren't in faith. You are in assumption, okay? You assume that you've got it there, but you literally haven't worked the process. That's like a ridiculous farmer who actually doesn't plant the seed, but he drives his tractor around the field like the guy next door, and he goes, yeah, well, he's going to get a harvest. I'm going to get a harvest. Did you actually put seed in the ground? Did you actually put nutrients in the soil? Did you actually protect it from herds of cows next door? Did you actually stop it when it comes to weeds and thistles? Did you actually protect this crop? Because if you didn't, oh, you can talk big. But at harvest time, when that guy's got a 100-fold return on his crop and all you got's a crop of weeds, you're going to start blaming God. Well, I don't understand. I did everything right. No, you didn't. And if we keep blaming God for everything that goes on negative in our lives, we will never be able to get victory. And so we've got to recognize we must learn this process. And I'm going to challenge you today. You know, I was talking the other day to some of our real estate guys, and I mean, you think they just out chat with people and make money. They are learning and growing, understanding people, understanding the markets, so that when they're with you, they can make the sale of that house. They're with you for an hour or two, and they need to make a sale. They need to know their stuff. They need to be confident. They'll fly all over the world to conferences to learn how to close, learn how to do all these things. Now listen, real estate guys. How much time do you spend in the Word of God to look after your heart? Because it's the most productive thing for sales there ever is your heart. You can move to a level of prosperity and blessing that you could never do in the natural with all the best teachers going. You can go to a level that would blow people's minds once you got your heart connected. You know, you can, teachers, you've studied for years to get up and understand children and to teach them topics. But when you talk about you preparing your heart, working the process of faith so that you have faith. Well, I don't have time. It's just the most ridiculous comment I have ever heard when someone tells me they don't have time to get into God's Word. We're not getting into God's Word to get a star on our attendance form. We're not going into God's Word to keep Him happy. No, we're going into God's Word because there's an autopilot on you. And this thing called the heart must be persuaded by this process. And the process is taught to us by Jesus. And if you do not work the process every day, then welcome to the greatest frustration going, because you like the quick verses like, call unto God and He answers. Listen, get it in context. Or, you know, when I pray, He answers. Of course He does. But do you understand how to believe at the heart level? So I really want to convince you of this, that you need to do this work. You can't, you know, all my life as a teacher, I've always tried to make it simple for people. And I got, for a while there, I got mixed up with the powerful simplicity of the gospel and no work. No, it's work. Okay, like farming, and it's basic. You can say it's simple. Put the seed in the soil and the soil produces a harvest. Yes, but most people won't do the work. And so I want to make sure that you recognize that every day of your life that we need to work the process. In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 2, it says there, and it talks about people listening to the Word of God. And it says, some, when they hear the Word, they just prosper. And others, it says nothing, because they don't mix faith with what they hear. And, you know, another version says that they don't accept the Word, combine it, and join it with faith. Another translation says, they only heard it, and they did not believe it as well. When you are hearing the Word of God, like you're hearing it right now from your pastor, or the mouth you hear the most is you, okay? Because you're talking to your wife this hour, talking to a boss next hour, talking to five clients, you know, all these, but you're listening to yourself talk all the time. So when you hear your own words, you've got to begin to believe that those words are going to come to pass. You know, I'll drop little nuggets here and there that I'll deal with further on, but if you want to know one of the quickest ways I ever began to rise up in stronger faith, it's when I begin to declare that everything I say happens in Jesus' name. Everything I say happens in Jesus' name. I rise up and say, Father, I want to thank You, everything I say happens. Say, well, Leon, that's dangerous. You bet it's dangerous. And that's why if you hang around me long enough, it's pretty rare that I make a slip up and say something deathly about my kids or about myself or about my finances or about the future. We'll discuss stuff and work on things, but I'm not going to sit here and curse things. Jesus put a curse on a fig tree. He just said, no one's going to eat from you anymore. And that fig tree in the next 24 hours died. There was a curse put on it. Words can be curses. Words can be blessing. And we need to understand this incredible power wrapped up in the forming and the release of a word. Words carry fear. Words carry faith. I can hear someone sing, I love you, I love you, and it's just beautiful and precious. And I can hear somebody else sing the same song, I love you, and feel just creepy and gross because there's something different in that word coming off of that person. We need to mix faith with what we hear. So when we dive into God's Word, this mixing of faith with what we're hearing, this working of at persuading our hearts. Well, yeah, I thought we weren't into works. No, we're not into works to get God to do something. But God's already given us His promises. He's given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. What we need to do is stop living like a doubter and live as a believer. That's why we are called believers. And it's the simplest process. And as we begin to renew our minds and learn this process and work this process, your life, I'm telling you, if you will listen to me in these next number of weeks, as I'm diving into this thing, I'm going to take it apart. And, you know, people who are lazy, you're not going to get this. You're going to get bored with me. But someone who gets this and goes, I'm going to change my life forever. I am going to go do some heart work. I'm going to persuade my own heart. You will never be the same. I promise you, because my life is never the same when I continue to do this. And when I look back over my life, I look at the certain times when I kind of got discouraged and got out of the process. And I'll explain it to you. So, well, yeah, it sounds so clinical. Well, I don't care. For some of you, I need to bring it down to here because you're so mystical. Well, you never know what we're going to get. I mean, we just don't know what's going to happen. Yes, I do know what's going to happen. The Bible tells me to prophesy my future, declare my future, and the Holy Spirit's going to work with me to show me my future, and I can depend on God that my future is secure if I'll work this process. Well, my time is up here, and I'm going to continue. For those of you who are following me, I will be teaching on this for a long time because I believe it's the thing that the Christian church has ignored at its own peril. So we're going to dive in, and I'm going to show you this process, how to work it. And I'm going to show you from the faith perspective, meditation perspective, but you are going to love this. It changed my life. And anytime now, as I look towards the future, and I'm believing for something more, something new, something bigger I've never seen or done before, all I have to do is work the process, and I know it's going to happen. And so I want you to understand this. I want you to know this. So be excited. Take the verses down that I've already shared with you. Begin to read Mark chapter 4, the entire chapter, over and over and over. Let's stay there for a while because I'll be pulling truths out of there I know that so many have never even seen. And it's going to revolutionize your life. Father, I just pray right now, the presence of God, that you would touch them in a deep and a beautiful and a powerful way. That, Father, there be an excitement inside of them to dive into your word, to get to know you and to work this process that you have so plainly shown us and that changes everything in our life. I speak life over them. For those who are listening who don't know you, I pray right now they would say, Jesus, I choose you. I believe on you. Come into my heart. And Father, you'll guide them in this wonderful life. In Jesus' name, amen.